This is Retirement News Online. Welcome back. So despite the stellar performance of the U.S. indices since 2009, they have failed to outshine the European market indices this year on year-to-date performance metrics. Now, the devil is always in the details, they say, and for those details, we turn to Zach Abraham. He's CIO with Bulwark Capital Management in Seattle, Washington. Zach, welcome. So should investors start thinking about European equity markets right now?
On a valuation basis, I think that value for a variety of different reasons. First of all, this has been the longest period of time where value has underperformed growth stocks on record. It's the longest period of time of underperformance, and it's also the greatest performance gap. So, you know, the difference between the two is the widest in history, and the length of time this has lasted has been the widest in history. And I think there's a variety of reasons for that. I think some are justified, some are clearly not. I think that gap has gotten historically wide, and I think it's going to be a problem. And, you know, just when everybody pivots to one side of the boat, it's probably not the right decision to be doing the same thing as an investor. And consequently, we've seen that over the last 2 months where I was telling our clients that this is, thank God for us, because we are definitely tilted to value. This is one of the biggest periods of outperformance I've witnessed in my career, where our value portfolio has tripled the S&P return over the last 2.5 months. It's just been rocketing. So looking through a value perspective, Europe and a lot of other, not just Europe, but a lot of other emerging markets as well, look historically cheap. Now, that being said, we are not currently piling into European stocks, and there are some factual database reasons for that. Then there are also some more anecdotal reasons for that. So on the fact-based side of it, it's the tough thing about value. Sometimes things are cheap because they're undervalued. Sometimes things are cheap because they should be. And on a bounce basis, markets can do whatever they want to do. It wouldn't surprise me to see European equities and consequently other international equities get a bit of a bounce here. I don't currently think, you know, we want a well-diversified portfolio where we're properly spread across different markets with global exposure. But I certainly don't think that the time now is to overweight European equities. And the reason for that is that the reason European equities are cheap is because that economy continues to malfunction. The issues that have hurt that economy in the last 10 to 20 years have only become bigger problems. We sit here and tend to focus on the debt side of our economy and that it's a problem, and that problem is significantly worse in Europe. You have structural issues with Brexit where we don't know how that's going to play out. I honestly believe, regardless of what outcome comes from Brexit, that the consequences are much less impactful than the European Union would have you believe. And so I don't think that that's a huge driver. It's just very hard, whether we're looking at birth rates, whether we're looking at political structures, whether we're looking at debt loads, it's very hard to believe that there's going to be this economic renaissance around the corner for Europe. So
yeah.
The other thing is, anecdotally again, Scott, my entire career I have heard that Europe is a buy because it's cheap. It has never been the case. So, you know, so could it outperform? Sure. I mean, it's possible. But, you know, you look at messes like Deutsche Bank, that story's not over. The stock might have bounced a little bit. It's given a lot of those gains back. Europe has massive issues. And unlike us, we haven't dealt with them, but we did recapitalize our banks. Europe still hasn't done that.
Mm-hmm.
So that's going to have to get dealt with at some point. And none of that's going to be positive for GDP growth in the beginning. So to us, that's kind of a long story. Now, on the, again, getting to the anecdotal side of it, from our point of view, U.S. equities, especially ones that are value tilted or value related, are much more attractive to us right now, because everything we look at, this economic run is petering out, for lack of a better term. And I think the story going forward for quite some time is going to be capital flight. because of all the issues. You know, you look at what's currently going on right now, you know, in Venezuela. Then you look at what's currently going on in is it Bolivia? I believe it's Bolivia, where the president of Bolivia just got ousted, or basically had a coup because of nefarious activity he was engaged in as it related to the election. So all these hot issues around the world continue to inflame, continue to get worse, and we think that that's going to continue to propel capital flight. We see the situation in China continuing to deteriorate. That's going to propel more capital flight. And when capital flight becomes an issue, where is that money, the disproportionate amount of that money, where is it going to land?
Mm-hmm. Zach, would it be safe to say that Europe is really just a shiny object right now with the Greek, French, and Italian indices this year, and much more thought needs to take place before somebody just jumps ship?
Right. So, again, what we're telling clients is we are going to stick with our globally diversified model, but now is not the time to step on gas in all of these other things. Here's the other side of it that I think is interesting, is because so much of this run-up for the last 10 years, and this really, look, you might find some people to disagree with this, but the facts disagree strongly with them for a variety of different reasons, but the vast amount of propulsion in markets over the last 10 years has been central bank activity, period. And if you want to go, well, how do you know that, Zach? Well, if we look at it, global GDP growth, and especially here in the United States, GDP growth, since the crash in 08-09, the U.S. economy has had nominal GDP growth between 1.75 and, you know, depending on how you're looking at it, 1.75, 1.9%. That's been the average. Okay, and that's nominal, meaning that's the amount the GDP has grown total if we start from top to bottom. Then what we have to do to come up with a piece of data called real GDP growth is then we need to subtract the inflation rate for every one of those years, right? Because if you think about it, it makes sense. What is your growth rate? But then what is your growth rate after inflation? Because that's the real growth story. So inflation during that entire 10-year run-up has averaged right around 2. So you can make the argument, and the data shows that real growth in the United States has been less than 0, right? So over that same period of time, the S&P has tripled. Then you go look at the Great Depression. The Great Depression had a lower nominal growth rate at like right around 1.35, but they had 0 inflation. And look at the performance of assets during the Great Depression. They didn't triple, right? It took 24 years for the market to get back to the highs of 29. So, this cycle, because of central bank intervention, we've referred to it as cycle of opposite. So literally things have been, not everything, but across the board, there's been this consistent correlation of things typically happening in this cycle in reverse order. And right now what is going on is kind of an example of that. What we typically see at the end of economic cycles are these economic blow-offs where the as you put it, the shiny objects, the overpriced, more speculative stuff tends to get a rally and you see a blow-off in markets at the end. We've already seen that happen, and what you're starting to watch is a blow-off in value, which should be something that starts a rally. So again, pivot to Europe. I prefer to pivot to Europe in the beginning of an economic rally, not toward the end of it. So as always, we can certainly be wrong, but I'm chuckling at all these guys saying now's the time for Europe, because I think that in time that will be seen as, you know, jumping out of the frying pan into the fire. And that's kind of where we think that'll end up.
That's Zach Abraham in Seattle, Washington, and this is Retirement News Online. Thanks for watching.